Welcome to the Alpha Girl Confidence Podcast, where we are empowering youth female athletes to play and live confidently. My name is Shay Haddo, and each week I will bring you new episodes to teach you the strategies and tools that you need in order to live a confident, empowered life, both on and off the playing field. What's up, and welcome back to the show. So I'm super excited to share today's episode with you, where I got the opportunity to sit down with my former Utah State teammate, Natalie Norris, or as everyone knows her, Nano. So Nano is the director of sports nutrition at Utah State. She's the head coach of the boys and girls programs at Logan High School, and she is a two-time All-American. And most importantly, Nano is just an amazing human being. So on this episode, we go into some of the medical struggles that Nano had to deal with in her college career, high school career, and in her professional career. We go deep into general guidelines for players as far as fueling up pregame and postgame. We go into some of the misconceptions in the nutrition industry and really where parents and players can go to find good resources in a sea of misinformation. So if you're a parent or a player or even a coach listening to this episode, it's going to be very valuable for you to listen to the wisdom that Nano provides. I hope you enjoy this conversation. It was so fun for me to get back with an old teammate. So I hope you enjoy it as much as I did. Nano, what's up? Welcome to the show. I'm so excited to have you. I was like, when you were coming on, I was like a little girl in a candy shop, I guess. But yeah, you're the first former teammate that I've ever had on the podcast, I'm pretty sure. So I'm excited to have you on and catch up and all of the things.
I'm honored. I'm pumped to be here. I was so excited when you asked me. So this is fun to be able to see you.
When we were talking, I was like, why haven't I asked her to come on yet? I'm asking her. So I'm glad it happened. I don't even remember why we started talking, but it was meant to be, I guess.
It was definitely.
So obviously, guys, Nano is my former teammate at Utah State. And Nano, I don't know if people still call you Nano, but that's all I am ever going to call you. So I'm not going to call you Natalie. So I'm calling you Nano. Hope that's okay.
All about it.
So tell listeners a little bit about your playing career, and then we'll definitely dive into like what you're doing right now.
Okay. Well, I played at Utah State, obviously, with you, Shay. I was there from 2009 to 2012. And then I went and played professionally for a season with FC Kansas City, mostly as a reserve. And then I came back and coached at Utah State as an undergraduate assistant while I finished my second bachelor's. And then was deciding to go back or not. And I ended up having surgery right when I got back and decided grad school was the way to go for me. Partly religious reasons, partly body not holding up.
Yeah.
And then I have been playing in like WPSL and the UWS. I played there for 11 years with Real Salt Lake Women. And then I now coach. So I coach at high school. Never thought that was going to happen this fast, at least. I'm the head coach of the girls and the boys team at Logan High in Logan, Utah.
Awesome. And then what do? You forgot the part about, what you do for Utah State nutrition.
My job. So I am back at Utah State. I got hired out of my master's to come back and teach a half load. So I teach a couple of nutrition classes, an introduction to nutrition class, and then an advanced sports nutrition class. And then I'm the sports dietitian for the athletic department and the director of sports nutrition, I guess.
Yes, Nano, the director of sports nutrition. And if you guys listening, I'm going to be tooting Nano's horn for her because she's like way too humble. So what two-time All-American, like, you know, all of the things, literally the best center back, Taryn, if you're listening, you too, but the best center back that I have ever played with, like me as like a 6 and an 8, a center midfielder. Honestly, I could just chill and Nano would have my back. So like Nano was the most beast of a player I've ever played with. So yeah, Nano, I'm going to toot your horn just a little bit because, you know, you deserve it.
Thanks.
So we kind of talked about this before, but like some of your challenges, because I know you had you know, your body didn't want to hold up and you had some, you know, health challenges with your compartment syndrome. So first off, what is that? And like, how did it affect everything with your career?
It really did affect everything.
Yeah.
Compartment syndrome can be a chronic or acute pain disease, and mine is chronic. I developed it in high school and it just got worse and worse and worse every single year I played. And essentially there's this layer of tissue around your muscles. It's called a sheath, I guess, the muscle sheath, and it doesn't expand. And I was born with it to be too small. And so anytime my muscles tried to expand or I worked out or did anything on my calves or toes, so like soccer,
yes,
was one of the worst for that. My muscles would try to expand and it couldn't. And so pressure would build up and blood would go places it wasn't supposed to. And it was just this crazy pain sensation every single time. I got to the point where I was in college. It climaxed at Kansas City. Okay. But I would feel it about 15 minutes into a practice or a game. And I was just in excruciating pain. And I could stretch to relieve it for like seconds. Mm-hmm. And then other than that, I just kind of had to play through it. It was worth it to me to play through it. And so,
yeah. I just know, like, you know, obviously I have no idea what that pain felt like, but just remembering you always trying to stretch your calves and shake them out and just like still pushing through. And I'm like, oh my gosh, like what kind of like mental, like how was that mentally? Cause obviously so many players would just be like, no, I'm done. Or like, I can't do this and use it as a crutch, but you never used it as a crutch. You never use it as an excuse or anything like that.
Honestly, that probably built a lot of my mental character because it did start in high school, but I just loved the game of soccer. I still do. To this day, if I could play it all day, every day, I would.
Yeah, you would.
I just love it. but it just, I just saw it as another obstacle. Like it was just something to overcome. It was something that was worth pushing through to play. And I wanted to prove that I wasn't making excuses.
Yeah.
And so I never wanted that to be something, like we did have to adjust my fitness when I was my junior and senior year, I was on a bike instead of on the field, but I tried so hard to make it something that was personal. So I didn't have to like project it onto other teammates and then to just fight through it, because I had a couple of trainers say, well, we might just have to have you sit out practices and only play games. I was like, oh, heck no.
Right.
I am not doing that to my teammates. I refuse to just play games. Like, that's not fair to you guys. And so I was like, I'll do whatever I need to do. I was in the training room every day. My trainers didn't know what to do with me, but we made it work.
Like, seriously, like you're one of the best teammates, because that's the thing is like, we knew you were in pain just because of, you know, like how it affected you in the sense of stretching and stuff like that, but you never like outwardly verbalized it. Like you were never like, oh, my legs, my calves, like you never verbalized it. And then also just hearing from you now, like, that, and I knew this about you, but also that you didn't use that as an excuse to like not train, because how many players would be like, sweet, I would have done that. I would have been like, sweet, I don't have to practice. Like, cool, I just get to play in the games. Like, awesome, right? Because I don't know, I hated practice. But like so many players. And so I think that's why you gained the respect that you did, because of how you pushed through and how you like pretty much put the team before like yourself. And that was like, you know, I just so much respect for you for, you know, your mental resilience and all and going through that.
Well, thank you. That was I've been very blessed to heal really well from like pretty major injuries. And that one was just not one I'm going to heal from. Still have it to this day. So
yeah, totally. So let's get into nutrition a little bit, because obviously you are the nutrition guru. When did you get like really figure out that that's what you wanted to do?
It started in high school. My brother was kind of interested in nutrition. He was running cross country. So we started making like little changes with what we got from the grocery store.
Yeah.
And then I actually became the most interested in it because I saw some family members' nutrition that could be could be improved in different ways, and it was like affecting life.
Right.
And then as an athlete, obviously I noticed how much it impacted me. And I am an athlete who is constantly eating.
I was just going to say, every time I see you, you're snacking. When you showed up, you were snacking. Like, that's like, you know, like Ross on Friends, how, is it? Maybe I'm thinking of something else. I don't know. Someone on some TV show or movie that's always snacking. Maybe it's Brad Pitt and his movies. And like, you're always snacking. It's just like something like small and healthy though, all the time.
For real though. Like, I had to eat lunch as I was walking into the locker room to make it to halftime. And so I was like, all right, nutrition has to have a bigger impact than I'm thinking. So do you remember this? Oh, we weren't there the first year together. But my freshman year, I started pulling out a banana out of my bag at halftime every year, every game. And my coaches were like, Nano, what are you doing? I was like, coach, I can't make it through a game. Like, I can't do it. And that's how halftime snacks started for Utah State.
There you go. Thank you, Nano. Because when I got there, halftime snacks were already a thing. So I appreciate it. I did not know that.
Yeah, they were like, what is going on? I was like, I can't do it. My body is dying. I'm so hungry.
So you were like self-aware enough to just be like, this is what I need.
Yeah. So I just went for it. I had a banana almost every halftime. And then once we got snacks, I would have like a banana and Gatorade and like a little bit of something else. But I realized then that nutrition could either be, and I say this all the time to my athletes, could either be your secret weapon or your biggest downfall.
Totally.
So that kind of like family started it. And then once I became a bigger athlete, I was like, holy cow, like this is a big thing.
Yeah. And it's crazy because when we were playing together, we didn't have what they have now. We didn't have a fueling station. We didn't have one of you. Like our strength coaches kind of talked about it, but me, I was like the queen of Arby's, Chick-fil-A, McDonald's. Like, we ate out all the time, like fast food all the time. And I'm just thinking that looking back now, like if I would have actually paid attention to my nutrition, I probably would have been way better and like not have like been so tired all the time.
Yeah, I feel you.
What do you see as your athlete's biggest obstacle, I guess, when it comes to nutrition or just like learning about it and like starting to actually apply it?
I would say just lack of knowledge in general.
Yeah.
Like, there's a lot of athletes who just don't know how important nutrition is. There's some who I have come in and they're like, hey, I just want to know more about it. And I'm like, okay, like, where are we starting? Kind of thing.
Yeah.
There's such a big gap with sports nutrition, like how important it can be. There's a lot of misconceptions out there because like the nutrition world is like, carbs are evil. Fat is evil.
Sugar, it's crazy.
Evil. Carbs are great now. Nope. Fat's bad now. Nope. Fat's great. Like, so it's just like all over the place. And so it's hard to kind of navigate regardless if you're an athlete or not.
Even for me, it is.
Yeah. Like, it doesn't matter if you're an athlete or not. Like, who knows what's true and what isn't. And so it's just hard. I would say that's the biggest obstacle. It's just like, misconceptions from the media and from like Instagram coaches or like Instagram celebrity
influencers.
Like, whatever it might be. Like, there's just a lot of incorrect information going around and then not a lot of true information going around. So
So what are some of those biggest misconceptions that you see?
So the biggest one is that carbs are evil still.
Totally.
I feel like that kind of started out as like the big one, and that has stuck. Like, it's not as bad anymore,
but it's still there.
Yeah, it's definitely still there. And then another one is that like protein is all you need. Like, guys, no, I promise carbohydrates are good. Like, we need them.
Yes.
And so those two usually go hand in hand. There's a lot of athletes that come in and they're like, well, I'm really good about getting my protein. I'm like, Kay, are you really good about getting carbohydrates? They're like, no, we don't need those. I'm like, yeah, we do need those. So we just have to educate and kind of navigate that, because sometimes we've got athletes who are scared of them because of the media that has kind of gone around with it. And so my favorite analogy is like saying like carbs to your body is like gas to your car.
It's the biggest fuel source. As an athlete, it's like you have to have it.
Yeah, exactly. And like, granted, there's like that adaptation. You can go that route. But like typically for NCAA athletes with what is being required of them, like carbohydrates are so important.
Yeah. And what's the, I guess, the truth, if you will, to the whole protein thing?
So obviously protein is super important, but it's not more important than carbohydrate. And so the key is to get both in good amounts so that our body can utilize what's being brought in both ways. Like carbohydrates help get protein where it needs to go and help it be used for what it needs to be used for. Because if we're just getting protein in and skimping on the carbs, then protein is going to have to be used as a fuel source, which we hardly ever want to have.
Right.
But protein can be utilized super, super well to help strengthen muscle, regain anything that we lost or anything that we have, and try to like rejuvenate and refresh the muscle that we do have, as well as building. And so it is extremely important, but it just can't be at the cost of carbohydrates.
I got you. So since we're talking about macros, where do you see fat fitting into as we're talking about sports nutrition specifically?
Obviously still very important. That is a macronutrient I don't talk about quite as much with my athletes, just because the other two are like, so we have so much learning to do with that. But, if I ever see like an, in like a daily intake that is avoiding fat, then I'm like, okay, we've got to step in here a little bit. Like we obviously want to try and aim for healthy fats, like avocados and natural nut butters and nuts and things like that. And like fish is an awesome, awesome option. But typically we're getting enough fat throughout the day unless we're specifically avoiding it. If I always try and emphasize fish, because not a lot of college athletes eat fish.
Right. It's not really the college diet.
Yeah, no, not really. So the more we can like slide that in wherever we can, the better. Cause then a lot of people like peanut butter, a lot of people like avocados. So like we can just help them be a little more mindful of that. But fat is definitely necessary. Like there's some processes in your body that only operate if you have the specific fat or triglyceride in there.
Yeah.
So we've got to make sure we get it in.
Right.
Like fish oil can be super good for joints and muscle and collagen and like all the things. So.
Yeah. So let's simplify. What should a typical, and I have a follow-up question because I'm saying typical, but what should a typical pre-game plate look like for a soccer athlete?
Okay. So this depends on how far out you are. If we're eating, because there's some athletes who have to eat like 4 hours before, otherwise. So if we're like the farther out you are, the more you can eat and the more you need to eat. But if we're like two-ish hours out, the emphasis should be carbohydrates and then moderate protein and then moderate to low fat. Because if we're stacking on the protein and fat too close to it, then your stomach is going to
just, it just kind of sits there.
It just kind of sits and causes issues. So one of my favorite pregame meal is a PB&J with crackers. Yep. All about the PB&J.
Me too.
And I usually do it on wheat bread that far out. If I'm closer, then I do it white on bread. White or like something super simple, just so my body can handle it better.
Yes.
And then I do a piece of fruit, some crackers, and sometimes some veggies, sometimes not, depends on how I'm feeling that day. But like, that's kind of the main, my go-to. It's been my go-to for so long.
Yeah. I mean, like you found something that works for you, and if it works for you, like stick to it. There's no need to go, you know, experiment a bunch of different things if it works. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's really interesting with nutrition, is because it's so personalized.
Like, that's what I was going to ask you. I was going to say like how personalized is nutrition? Because our bodies are all so different.
Yeah.
So that's why I feel like nutrition industry is hard, because it's never one size fits all.
Correct.
How do you navigate that kind of with your athletes and like your education and stuff like that?
So there is some just like general principles for nutrition that will help sports nutrition in general, whether no matter what kind of athlete you are, like you should be eating every 3 to 4 hours. You need to be getting so much water. Like I usually aim for 3 to 4 of the Gatorade water bottles a day to have them go for. And then I try to get them to eat protein every single time they eat, except for pre-workout doesn't have to be as big of a emphasis.
Okay. Yeah.
But like if we're calculating things, it's based on your body weight and the amount of exercise or activity that you're doing on a day-to-day basis. And so if you have a really hard day Monday and a light day Tuesday and an off day Wednesday, like each of those days per person could be different.
Totally.
But so like the calculations, we just kind of, we go off the type of athlete they are. Like for protein, it's anywhere from 1.2 to 1.8 grams per kilogram.
Okay. Yeah.
The 1.2 to 1.4 is like more of our cross country or like our skills-based athletes. And then 1.5 to 1.8 is like the strength training and football and basketballs and soccer.
Right.
And so, and then carbs go anywhere from, typically the lowest we like to go is like 4 grams per kilogram. And that's like if you're just on a light day. But it's usually 5, it could be up to 12. Like if we've got anything like Ironmans or like whatever you might be doing. If you're a dual sport athlete, which is rare in college, but like it happens.
For sure. Yeah.
You should be eating a ton. People just don't realize quite how much it is.
Yeah. So
like typically, it's around like the most general, I would say would it be anywhere from 6 to 9 grams per kilogram for carbohydrate.
Okay.
And then you try and make it fit. Like you just have to kind of adjust numbers to make everything fit in the overall calorie range.
Gotcha. Okay, cool. So do you see athletes usually eat too little or eat too much generally?
Honestly, it's usually too little.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Yeah, they just kind of underfeed. And even sometimes they come in and they're like, well, look, like, this is what I eat. I'm like, hey, that's really good. Like you, it looks like an awesome intake kind of.
Right.
I think we're low. And they're like, what? Okay. I'm like, yeah. Like, I think if we eat just a little bit more, your body will react better and you'll be able to better. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, how can someone know, like, if they don't have, you know, they're not necessarily tracking all of that, because that's kind of a pain. Like how, is there a way to just kind of intuitively know, like, is there like a signal or a sign or, you know, something that they can kind of know, am I eating too much? Am I eating not enough? Like what's your take on that?
I would say yes. And most of it is based on your energy levels during practices and your ability to recover. So if you're hitting a wall, like during practices, when you feel like you should be able to like finish it out and be strong, then we're definitely under eating.
Okay.
If you're not able to finish or compete in races or games like you should be able to, like that means our nutrition is off.
Okay.
Whether we're not getting enough carbohydrates or not eating early enough or to like close enough to an event or just not enough in general.
Yeah.
And then recovery is also a pretty big indicator. If they are struggling to recover day to day, that means they're not fueling or refueling enough. I kind of look at it like a phone battery. Like that's a metric that I use. Like the more you're on your phone, the quicker it dies. So the more using your body, the quicker it's going to.
You need more juice.
Yeah. But then you need more juice. You got
not literal juice, but yeah. Like, okay. More apple juice. Sure.
Yeah. Okay. Perfect. But like, you've got to make sure that you're refueling. Cause otherwise if you're not recharging fully, then you're starting at like 50% the next day and you're going to hit rock bottom faster and faster and faster.
Totally.
And then cause problems with injury. You're going to be sleepy all the time. You're going to be
like, falling asleep in chemistry class.
Yep.
That's what I did all the time. Only chemistry. I don't know why.
I fell asleep in chemistry all the time too.
Oh, there's something with chemistry, I guess.
You're right.
So then refueling. So you kind of went over pregame. What about postgame? Because I think a lot of times people don't think about that. They're just like, I'm just going to go do whatever. So what about postgame fueling up?
So there used to be people thought there was like this really critical time window immediately after, like that 30 to 45 minutes that you had to get something in.
Yeah.
And it's beneficial to get something in, but it's not detrimental if you don't.
Cool. I used to think that too. I'm like, yeah, oh, I have to eat now.
Yeah.
But okay, cool. I would like yell at my parents if they didn't feed me soon enough.
For real. Like, and then there's some people who are like, I don't want to eat for the next 4 hours. I'm like, what?
Yeah.
I'm starving.
Yeah.
Like right now.
Oh, totally. First thing. Give me food.
But as long as we're eating a good solid meal within 2 hours that has carbohydrates, protein, and fats along with liquid, hopefully we're getting electrolytes in post before we eat. That's usually easier to kind of stomach, is liquid in of some kind. But that is adequate, and that'll start your recovery good enough, unless you have 2-a-days, or like if you're in a tournament. For remember when we had to do like 3 games a day and we're like, wait, what?
Yes.
Never do that anymore. But like doing the in between is super important. Like we got to get on nutrition really big, but typically with just a normal post game within that 2 hours, getting a good solid meal, which I describe as your main entree plus at least 2 sides or 2 other food items. Okay. So
what is your take on, I feel like most Americans have a horrible diet, but on vegetables, like how important are vegetables just in general? I'm trying to get these kids to eat more vegetables. So talk to us about the importance of just like real food.
Yeah. Real food is the best way to go. I can just going to say that right now. But veggies and fruits, the colorful foods are so, so important for our diet. They provide so many, they're not nutrients, but they're phytochemicals that give you so many benefits. And then they also, like the whole fruit and the whole vegetables, give you fiber, make you a lot more full.
Yeah.
And then they provide, like I said, those phytochemicals. And so whenever I'm teaching my athletes, I'm always like, okay, eat the rainbow.
Totally.
But we gotta look at the fruits and vegetables. And so like the more colorful you can make your plate, the better. Typically, I'll be straight up honest, I am so lazy when it comes to vegetables. I love vegetables, but I'm so lazy.
Me too.
So like summertime, one of my favorite times to like grill or roast or broil veggies with like olive oil and some seasoning, favorite. But what I do during season is just, especially if I'm on my own, I do the steamables or like the brand ones, because frozen vegetables can be just as healthy as regular vegetables, as long as they're not prepared in like sauces and
gravy.
Stuff like that. But yeah.
Piled it with ranch on top. That's my favorite way.
Hey, but you can get, if you get your vegetables in, it's better than nothing.
There you go. There you have it. Yeah. Just so like, kind of last nutrition, well, maybe I might come up with more questions, but kind of last nutrition point is, where in the heck can, there's like we talked about, there's so much muddiness and like, where should I find like actual, real, good, truthful advice versus this is just garbage advice? Like how do we know, first of all, that it's real, and where can players go to like actually get really good resources on how they can, you know, have better nutrition?
No, that's a great question. There is a lot of sports RDs out there.
Yeah.
So, and it's becoming a more popular profession and a more widely needed profession. So like the industry is growing a ton, but it is still hard to try and find people. So like you can look on Instagram and find like, the biggest thing is registered dietitians. Granted, I'm not going to say that all registered dietitians are like, you're human. Like you're going to have bias. You're going to have lack of nutrition knowledge, but generally like we have the background to back up what we're saying. And then sports RDs. So there's a test, like a certification, it's a CSSD, and that's a registered sports dietitian that you had to take an additional exam that, and you had to work with athletes for 2 years before you can get it done.
Okay, cool.
But those credentials matter. and should help give us a little bit better information. But there are several dietitians who are working on getting sports nutrition websites up that are more accessible to high school athletes, to younger kids, to college athletes who don't have dietitians. So it's just a matter of finding the right information. So like usually like the .orgs or the .edus are better information, like blogs and like
a blog from Becky.
Yeah,
exactly. No offense to anyone named Becky, all right? Yeah. That's the first thing that came out.
It just rolled right off the tongue. But there are a couple books out there and things like that. But it really is just trying to find the more quality information coming out from the people who have the education.
Yeah. And there's like, there's definitely a lot more registered dietitians. Like I've had some come on my podcast, some like come in my groups and stuff like that. So I think just looking at that as opposed to, you know, looking and seeing if Becky's got a nice butt, right? Like the Instagram world is so, you know, saturated with people that, maybe they get good results for themselves, but it's just different when there's like some actual, credibility behind it.
Sure. For sure. Cause like anyone can call themselves a nutritionist, and that's something that not a lot of people know. Like my 3-year-old niece could call them. Yourself.
Maybe I should add that to my title.
Do it.
I'm just kidding. I'll stick to what I know.
But then like a registered dietitian, you have to go through a really strict process to get those credentials. So
yeah. So you are the real deal.
I try to be.
You're the real deal. Nice. Okay, cool. So I want to shift a little bit into coaching just because I'm curious, like for myself and curious for other coaches that listen. So you coach boys and girls, high school.
Yep.
Which one you prefer coaching?
I don't know. I really like different aspects of each of them.
Okay, let's talk about it because I've coached both. What do you like about the girls that you maybe don't like about the boys and vice versa?
So this is kind of like a player personnel thing. The girls want to be me, like they want to get to where I got. And so they have a lot more, respect.
I was going to say respect. Yeah.
Response to what I'm saying. Cause like they see and they know that I've been where they want to be.
That you're a star. So they're pretty,
they're pretty responsive. But they've also like, with my teams, they've also been really willing to do whatever I ask and they see the results. And so then they get excited and they keep working with it.
Yeah. I have a point. Girls, I feel like just always want to please the coach because they're more general people pleasers. Yeah. Right. So I think that's part of it too, is like, yes, coach, like I always want to do what the coach tells me to do generally. Yeah. Okay. Continue.
Yeah. With the boys, I like their style of play better usually. Like,
interesting.
I'm kind of like a bigger, faster, stronger.
You are
kind of player. And that's like, we have that ability a little more with the boys just because they are faster and they are stronger just typically than girls. But honestly, like, I don't know, like I say that, but then my girls play really pretty possession soccer. Like,
yeah. I'm a possession, of course. You know, yeah. I was never the fastest, obviously. but yeah, that's why I like women's soccer so much better because it's way more my style. But
so I like I get my boys to play possession soccer. And when they do, holy Hannah, we look so good. But and then they've got like the speed and athleticism kind of edge on their side. So it kind of gives us both ways. But the girls, like the first year I coached that team, holy Hannah, we looked so good.
Yeah.
And they just hadn't ever like really done a huge possession based soccer. And I came in and kind of, they're like, why are we doing possession every day? And I was like, I promise it'll work. Just trust me.
Well, didn't you guys win the championship?
No.
You got close.
We were in semis our first year. Yeah.
So pretty much we'll just say yes, you did.
Okay, cool.
Nobody knows. Just kidding.
Yeah, it's fine.
And how do you coach them differently? Like, does your personality, or your, I don't know, just how you coach them, does it differ between the boys and girls?
A little bit. Yeah. Cause boys can take a little more criticism.
Yeah, totally.
I can be a little more like to the point with them. Girls, I kind of have to like wrap it up in a blanket for them.
Totally.
With some players, that's the thing though. Like, it's a players are different, and so like,
yeah,
the girls' team, some players I can like be a little more hard with, and some I need to like kind of get to the point, but like do it in the kindest way I possibly can. Granted, I try to coach in a kind way in general.
Yeah, I mean, you're a pretty kind person overall, I'd say. So yeah.
Thanks. But like, there's definite differences. Like boys, I can just be like, what are you guys doing? Like, this is terrible. And they're like,
and they'll show up and they'll, yeah, and they'll do it. Girls are gonna crumble.
Yeah. So there's definitely, and like, even my girls are getting to that point where they know I'm just like, okay. Yep. What's happening? And they're like, all right, we'll change. And I'm like, okay, good.
Yeah.
But so I think it, I don't know, coaching, I'm sure you know this, is all about relationships. Like, mm-hmm, you've got to know your players and you've got to know what makes each of them tick. And so,
yeah,
it depends on the individual player, just like,
right, totally,
very individual. But
yeah, I mean, when I coach boys, I actually like myself as a person more when I coach girls, because I can be more myself, more chill, more laid back. But with boys, I felt like I had to like, oh, like, you know, be like tougher and not let them walk all over me and like that kind of stuff. And I didn't have as much fun with that. But yeah, it was kind of the same thing where I could be more blunt and just like straight up, like say what's on my mind. Whereas with girls, I got to like, maybe think about, okay, how do I say this to where she isn't going to take it the wrong way? Because girls, as we know, can take something so personally, and you're like, no, I didn't mean it that way. Like, you're good enough. I just need you to do this differently. Yeah. But like, that's what why I wanted to ask you that is because, you know, coaches so often coach them the same way. And it's really important that obviously you have to coach each player differently, but especially the boys and the girls, you have to kind of, you know, change it just a little bit.
It's a whole different thing, I feel like.
Yeah. Girls are tougher in a lot of ways.
Yeah. But I totally feel like, luckily, it's kind of fun with my boys because granted, it's hard. I'm one of two girl coaches of boys soccer teams in the state of Utah.
And no way.
Yeah. Me and my mentor, actually.
That's amazing.
My assistant coach when I was at high school is now the head coach of the girls and the boys. And so it's kind of crazy. But I know there's a lot of backlash from that, for being a girl head coach. And I see it and hear it all the time.
Tell me more.
Well, there's a lot of chatter saying, like, we had a really rough year this year, for instance. And I heard a lot of chatter saying that it was because I'm a girl that I couldn't, like, I didn't have the ability to get the boys where they needed to go. And I was like, this is the thing. Like, when they do what I ask, we destroy the other team. When they don't and they want to do it on their own, we get annihilated.
Right.
And like, there's nothing, I've never felt so helpless as a coach as I did this year.
That's so frustrating.
My assistant and I were just every day, we're just like, I don't know what else we can tell them. Like, they're what we're saying is going in one ear and out the other. And so I'm just like, all right. But like, community, parents, other coaches, like, I can see that there's like definitely still like the sexism going on. But luckily, and yes, it gets to me. There's definitely, like you were saying at the beginning, like, there's hard days with that. But most of the time, like, I know my worth to a point. Like, I don't, at the same time, like, confidence is something that I am constantly working on.
Mm-hmm.
But like, the boys, the fun thing for me is that I can still take it to the boys. Like,
totally. Yeah.
They know that I'm like, I could back up what I'm saying.
Totally. Yeah.
So that's one, like, the boys typically are pretty good about respecting me. But it is interesting being in such a male dominant world and being a girl.
It's crazy. Yeah. Cause when I was coaching boys too, I was the only female coaching boys, you know, that I knew of.
Yeah.
And it's just, there's this, you just feel this pressure on you that if you don't do well, it's because you're a girl, because you're a female. And it just, like, that's one reason why I got out of coaching, you know, for club and stuff. Cause I just knew I wasn't going to get respect the way that I deserved. And I think, you know, we could spend a whole hour talking about this. I'm like, okay, Shay, calm down. Like, I get a little heated. So we won't go down a rabbit hole, but it's just interesting to hear that you've kind of dealt with that as well. And also going back to your resilience, that even though you've gone through this stuff, you know, with, you know, being, we'll just say, call it discriminated against or whatever, that you've continued to like show up and do it, and you'll prove them wrong.
Well, it's a constant battle, but, and you know it, it's a constant battle every day. But thank you for that, Shay.
Yeah, I believe in you, and you believe in me. And that's all that matters. We got you. Got you. The Alpha Girl fam believes in Nano.
Thanks.
All right, Nano, any last, if you were to leave the listener with kind of one piece of nutrition, advice, guideline, what have you, what would that be?
That is a great question. I would say take care of your body. So, and listen to it. So there, I feel like there's so much going on that we have kind of overruled like our natural cues and our instincts of like what we should eat. Like people will tell us, and we're like, but I hate that. I'm like, don't eat it then. Like find another way to get it. Like, but take care of it and listen to it. Like make sure you're feeding it what it needs to be fed. But at the same time, you can still have ice cream. You can still have cookies. You just can't eat them all day, every day. Yeah, right? Like I'm all about it.
I like, love that.
My athletes appreciate, because I just try to relate to them as much as I can. I'm like, guys, I eat ice cream. I love it. Like, I'll see athletes at Cold Stone, and they will be so awkward, and they won't say hi.
They're like, oh, no, she's here.
Yeah. I'll call them out the next day, and I'm like, why didn't you say hi? They're like, well, we were eating ice cream. I'm like, clearly, so am I. Like, I'm also at Cold Stone.
Yeah, what, you're just, like, checking in. You're just checking in on them, going to all the ice cream shops. Are you? You know, going to Charlie's, going to Aggie Ice Cream, checking out everyone.
So I would say feed it, take care of it, but also and still enjoy food. Like, yeah. Don't be scared of it. We've got to figure out a way to kind of normalize food and normalize eating again.
I want to echo the whole, like, listen to your body thing. Like, if you feel tired, if you feel off, there's probably something that's off. So like, listen to your body over just like junk that you read on the internet. Like your body is very, very wise. So yes. You just gotta listen to it. And a lot of times if you just listen to it, it's gonna do the right thing.
Yep. And that goes for like training too. I'm like, if you're dead, take an off day. Like relax, go on a walk instead of destroying yourself in another workout.
Gosh.
We're told to do it. Like, you know?
We just have another hour topic we could talk about. Like, okay, are you going to come back on next month? And then the month after that, it's just like a Nano series of like all of the things that we could talk. She's like, no, I'm out of here.
Hey, I would love to, if you want to meet back.
Of course. Of course. Okay, cool. Well, thank you, Nano. I know like you're not like a big old social media person, are you? But any resources you want to point anyone to or anything like that?
I should have better resources but I'm really just not on social media a ton. And so I haven't really picked out some of the better ones. Maybe I should do that.
And I respect that, but I wanted to give you some space. There was something you wanted to share, great. If not, then your wisdom is the most valuable thing there is. You coming on here and talking is the most valuable thing ever. So I appreciate you so much. I'm so glad we got to catch up. And I know that the girls listening are going to get a ton out of it just as I did. So thanks again for coming on.
Thanks, Shay.